Well, thank you for the introduction. I'm pleased to be in Rome, and thanks to all of you that I woke up early and came to listen to our research. So I would like to talk about the way I look at this regenerative medicine, and I'm going to talk about two particular areas. One is adherent CD34, which we call omnicyte, so which is about CD34. And the other thing about small activating RNA. So with small activating RNA, we can, with the use of oligonucleotide, we can upregulate any of the 25,000 gene. So you can change, you will see by the end of the talk, you can change the fate and the strengths of the CD34. And it's not only CD34, but can be mesenchymal stem cell and so forth. My presentation will be on first on the clinical use as well as in vitro work on CD34 positive cell in diabetes. And then I'll be talking about its use in patients with liver failure and then patients with stroke. And then I'll be talking about secreted factors that come out of the stem cell. And finally, the various use of this small activating RNA in regenerative medicine. So you all know about diabetes. Diabetes is the epidemic of this century. It is believed that by 2020, about a third of all the people in Europe will be diabetic. And it's mainly type 2 diabetes. We keep eating, we put on weight, we have fatty liver, and then we have type 2 diabetes. So type 2 diabetes is not like a child that is born without pancreas, but this is sort of inflicted by the way we live. I'll be mainly talking about type 1 diabetes, where there isn't really insulin secreted by the cell, and it is mainly an autoimmune disease. So there are a lot of work at the moment to try to tackle how to have insulin. There are, of course, all the big companies producing newer and newer type of insulin, especially with inhalation and so forth. There are very intelligent pumps, and it is believed that by 2020, FDA will approve the first intelligent pump that will measure the blood sugar and then according to the level of sugar will pump insulin. There are already advanced phase 1 and phase 2 that are very successful, mainly in Boston. Of course, there is a pancreatic transplant and islet cell transplantation, but they are not easy to do. You need 5 patients that die in order to collect their pancreas. You have to put the patient on immunosuppression, and they fail after 1 or 2 years. So I would like to talk about stem cell. And of course, there is the embryonic, the iPSC, the adult bone marrow. And I'm going to focus on the adult bone marrow, and in particular, on the CD34 positive cell. And as I mentioned, we have termed omnicyte, which is the adherent part of the CD34, and you put it in culture, and in actual fact, over 2 to 3 weeks, it go up by 3 to 4 log. So in the last decade, there has been a lot of work on how to take a somatic cell and to turn it into a cell that behave like an embryonic stem cell, which is induced pluripotent stem cell. So how to go from, for example, an ectoderm or a mesoderm into induced pluripotent stem cell and then come down as, for example, endoderm for pancreas. And 7 years ago, we started to do exactly the reverse. Is to go from mesoderm to turn it into endoderm, bypassing the iPSC, because for me as a clinician, I knew that once you start to talk about the possibility of cancer, it makes everybody scared, especially when you deal with patients with benign disease like liver insufficiency or diabetes. And this is another way is that we want to start with one lineage, how to end up with another lineage. And essentially, it's very clear, it's very well understood that it is a multi-stage. So you start with PDX1 for pancreas, duodenum, homeobox, and then neurogenin 3, neurod, neurogenin 3, the alpha cell, neurod, the delta cell. You have to go to the MAFA in order to get the beta cell producing insulin. And there is a very well-described protocol how to make cells produce insulin. However, the very small percentage of this cell will produce insulin. The amount secreted is small, and it's not regulated. Now, MAFA is not only the last one that produces insulin, but it's very important because once you upregulate all of them, which is very interesting. It is the master regulator of the beta cell, as well as the PDX1. But if you upregulate MAFA, you will upregulate all of them. You need to upregulate all of them in order to get mature insulin. And the nice thing is that once you differentiate the cell, there is no way back. So it is one-way differentiation. So you don't need to keep adding it on the cell. You add it, you upregulate all the factor, you cause the differentiation of the cell, and you don't need to add any more. So I mentioned at the start how we have developed a new technique how to use an algorithm to find out the sequence for oligonucleotide to upregulate gene. Essentially, the oligonucleotide go to the nucleus, and there on the promoter of the gene, and it upregulate the expression of the RNA. So when we did that, we could upregulate all the important transcription factor like PDX1, neurogenin 3, NeuroD, NX, NKX 6.1, MAFA, as well as the accessory protein, which is really great. And this is what you get in the end, you start with a bone marrow stem cell, CD34 positive cell, that don't secrete insulin. But when you add small amount of glucose in the culture media, they start to produce insulin. And when you add a lot, you have a lot of release of insulin as well as C-peptide. And this regulation is extremely important because there isn't a single diabetologist that will let you come near their patient if it is not regulated. The regulation is the most important thing in medicine. That's what allows you, if you don't have breakfast, you don't have insulin. But if you have a heavy breakfast, you'll have a lot of insulin. This is very important. Otherwise, you go into coma. And these cells can sense the sugar level and can secrete insulin accordingly. And you get the two chain of insulin, and these are histochemical staining to show you that it essentially stain for insulin and C-peptide. And that was the electron microscopy. And we have done a small study in patients that have liver kidney failure from advanced diabetes. And this patient had kidney transplant successfully, and they have to wait for 2 years while they get their pancreas transplant. And during that time, we took five patients, and we injected this cell that I showed you inside the dorsal pancreatic artery by the interventional radiologist. And we had no problem whatsoever. One of the from the technique itself, however, we couldn't get enough of the cell. However, one patient, you could see here, was taking 100 units of insulin, and then after the injection, his daily intake for some 6 months was reduced to 50 units of insulin, which is still requiring insulin, but it's a good start. And now we are working ways how to increase the bulk of the cell. This is our experience with in diabetic patients. Now I'm going to move into a patient with liver insufficiency. We know that there are some 300 million patients around the world with hepatitis B and hepatitis C, and although there is a lot of advances how to stop replication of hepatitis C, however, these patients still have liver cirrhosis and they have liver insufficiency. And in this patient, we have given them CD34 into the portal vein, and I'm going to show you some successes where you can see how in this patient how the bilirubin comes down and the serum albumin goes up after the injection. This was the first report in the world showing the feasibility of giving stem cell to patient with liver failure. We did another study on a patient with alcoholic liver cirrhosis, and you can see here the serum bilirubin, which is a very important indicator of liver function, how it decreased down halfway because the normal level is about 20. Not cure, but it is a halfway, and patients lose their ascites and they have better quality of life. And again, it's about how to increase the number of cell that we can give to the patient. All these patients had their own bone marrow stem cell cultured in a GMP lab at Imperial College. And here I want to show you the power of this small activating RNA, how to increase the function. So essentially the liver produces albumin, but also it causes detoxification. So all the toxins that are produced in our body are removed from the liver by this detoxification enzyme. And when our liver is not working well, whether due to viral hepatitis or alcohol or NASH or whatever, we cannot remove these toxins, and it affects our brain, and we develop something called encephalopathy, which is drowsiness and slowness of thinking, because these toxins are in the blood. And so an important thing is to be able to activate this enzyme, which you can see here on this side compared to the control, and using SARNA to upregulate the HNF4, hepatocyte nuclear factor 4, which is the master regulator of the hepatocyte, you get a significant increase in the CYP enzyme to cause detoxification. And in animal, you notice a decrease in serum ammonia. Now I'm going to move to the brain. So when patients develop ischemia, at the start, it is a small area of brain damage, just here. And if you do nothing within a day or so, it progresses and it becomes a large area of essentially death, brain death. This part is called penumbra. So the question is that if you can give the stem cell here, can you stop a small stroke becoming a major one? Patient with a small stroke can still walk, work, eat and drink. Patient like this cannot. So the question is that, can we stop it in time by giving this patient's stem cell? And the CD34, which is omnicyte, according to the growth factor you put on the cell, it changes character. So I showed you about insulin or liver, but again, with different cocktail of growth factor, you can make more neurons. And essentially, the Department of Health allowed us to do the first clinical trial in stroke in Europe, where patients that have anterior circulation ischemic stroke can have this cell. And you can see here, this was our first patient. This is a major part of the brain. That's a quarter of the brain has gone. If you do a study and look on 100 patients that have this sort of stroke, half of them die. The other half, only four, will go back to work. And what we did is that we had a ethical committee and the Department of Health approval that when the patient come after assessment, we put a needle in the iliac bone, we aspirate the bone marrow stem cell, and then it is processed in the GMP lab and then injected as soon as possible in the carotid artery. So you need the interventional radiologist to go from the groin to the and for the first week after stroke, the blood-brain barrier doesn't work. So anything you are going to inject into the carotid will go straight to the brain. And we did six patients, and they all we had no complication, and they seemed to do better. The five out of six went back to work. They all survived. And this is a very exciting area that we are going to pursue. These are the improvements of this. Now I'm coming to the last part of my talk, is that if you take the CD34 positive cell, and they do a lot of good for the patient, but essentially, what happened? Is it the cells themselves? When you do embryonic stem cell and induced pluripotent stem cell, you are expecting that these cells will last for a long time. But when you deal with bone marrow-derived stem cell, there is no convincing report, to my knowledge, that tells you that the cell stays there for a long time. At best, it is a week or so. And I think the effect is not from the cell, but by the secreted factor that come out of this cell. And you can see here, these are liver cells that are treated with toxin. And you can see here, they have been treated by something called TAA, thioacetamide. A lot of white. These are dead cells undergoing apoptosis. And if you add just the culture media without the secreted factor, you can see there are very few cells left, and essentially the vast majority of them are dying or dead, they are white. If you add the secreted factor from CD34, you can see very few apoptosis, and the cells are growing happily. And you can show exactly the same thing in vivo by just injecting the secreted factor, and here's the effect on the liver. You can see how you decrease the liver enzymes, the AST, the ALT, and you improve the serum albumin in this animal. So I think this is a nice way, because if in the hospital we have this secreted factor in our pharmacy, once a patient comes with a heart failure, liver failure, kidney failure, stroke, you don't have time to do induced pluripotent stem cell. You have no time to do anything, because their brain would go. But what you need to do is to be able to phone the pharmacy to tell them, can you give me one of this universal drug, because it doesn't need a particular patient. You can take it from Jacques and give it to John. And I think this is the way I see bone marrow-derived stem cell helping the acute rather than the chronic patient. And finally, this stem cell that we find in nature are excellent, but you can actually help them more. Let's suppose you want to downregulate inflammation. So you want to have this cell producing a lot of IL-10. So you can see here how we can put an oligo called PR1 for promoter 1 for the IL-10, and we increase the expression of the gene messenger RNA. And if you do ELISA, you can see that actually it is released in the cell culture. Any interleukin, if you want to, in the field of, if you want to increase the immune system and you want to upregulate the secretion of IL-2, you can do the same. You can do FOXP3 if you want to, if you are interested in the CD4 regulatory T cell. You can even get any cell. You can get the CD34 positive cell produce dopamine. you can get the liver cell produce dopamine because you need three genes. You need to upregulate three genes, FOXA, tyrosine hydroxylase, and MNX1A. If you can put the oligonucleotide on these three, and you can make any cell behaving like a different cell, because every cell in our body have 25,000 genes, but most of them are silent epigenetically, and some of them are active, the eye, the vision, the ear to hear, but you can make any cell do anything by changing the epigenetic regulation of this cell. So these are very exciting. Of course, you can do it with, lentivirus, but it's not easy to take lentivirus to the clinic. You'll have to do a lot of convincing for doctors. However, if you are doing oligonucleotide, this is no gene therapy, and that's much easier, and you can do it. And if you are interested, get in touch with me. I can send you saRNA in your area of interest. Thank you very much.